I'm afraid it'll never be safe to move back here. I'm afraid I won't ever be able to come back to this house.
More than 16,000 structures burned in the Eaton and Palisades fires. For those whose homes survived, like Claire Thompson's Altadena home, invisible threats remain.
It's beyond, you know, anybody's comprehension of how toxic this fire is. That's my belief, and that's also what I'm seeing in the data that I'm collecting.
Months after the fire, industrial hygienist Dawn Bolstad Johnson has found unexpected toxins inside some of these homes.
What's left behind could be a public health hazard, really. What we're finding in homes is lead, lithium, cadmium, chromium, beryllium, cobalt. I mean, those are all toxic metals. Beryllium in of itself is pretty scary to me, to have beryllium in your house.
Beryllium is a naturally occurring metal, BE on the periodic table. It's in everyday items like cables and microwaves, headphones, and vintage golf clubs. It's also used in the aerospace and defense industries. But when it burns, it becomes toxic. Exposure over time can cause serious health issues. Dawn has found beryllium in nearly 24 homes between Altadena and Pacific Palisades. It's the first time in her decades of assessing wildfire smoke damage that it's come back on her lab results.
I'm out here testing and honestly, like, I'm not sure I want to keep testing, knowing that I'm walking into contamination with lithium, beryllium. I mean, the heavy metals are scary.
It's unclear just how many homes are contaminated by beryllium. The group Eaton Fire Residents United has been collecting data from homeowners. Of the 184 homes that shared results, only 52 were specifically tested for beryllium. 24 of those tested positive for elevated levels.
If you're not sampling for it, then it's like it's not there. And that's very concerning to me.
At a UC Berkeley lab, beryllium is being used for nuclear energy.
For fusion systems and then for fission reactors.
Reluca Scarlat works with beryllium in salt form and follows strict safety protocols.
So in a normal work day, I would put on shoe covers, which look like this. Make sure that I don't have exposed skin.
The beryllium here is contained in boxes, and anyone who works in the lab has to go through health monitoring. As a solid or an alloy, beryllium doesn't pose a risk, but if it burns or is grinded, the particles can attach to dust or ash. Even small amounts when inhaled are toxic to humans.
We definitely know that it can cause diseases other than the lung disease that is often referred to as chronic beryllium disease or berylliosis.
Chronic beryllium disease can be fatal and is certainly life-shortening, according to Dr. Newman. It doesn't occur overnight, but develops over months and years.
If you develop symptoms of cough, shortness of breath, fatigue, one of the things that you know, your doctor needs to know is that you had a potential exposure to beryllium.
The Eaton and Palisades fires are prime examples of how wildfires are becoming more and more urban, and that could lead to more beryllium exposure.
A lot of the other wildfires were mainly biomass burning, so acres and acres of brush and trees and shrubs and hillsides and grass. And this is hillsides of homes and more homes and more homes. Every home is potentially contaminated. Some people aren't getting tested, they don't want to know. Some people don't have the money to test, so people are forced back into their homes. People shouldn't be going in their homes without respiratory protection until they know what's in there.
Claire is still waiting for results from Dawn's testing of her home. The labs are currently backlogged. In the meantime, she and her husband are living 30 minutes away from the place they still call home.
We're gonna try everything we can to, you know, remediate it and make it safe, but it's not just our house that's contaminated, it's, you know, all of Altadena. It's a public health issue at this point.